One must act arrogantly and rude. If not, one will be left with nothing. You should be afraid, be very afraid, because soon you and your family will no longer matter. Your people group will become marginalized and underrepresented, and they will lose their advantage, power, and dominance. They will be replaced or replaced by another group of people, and you and your people will be subjugated to shame and guilt. And this must be stopped at all costs. Even if it takes unfair treatment of others, even if there is distrust for the truth, violates one's most personal morals and ethics, it must be done. Where have you heard such a message? What does one do with such a message of fear? A fear that is at odds with God's love. Perhaps all one can do is hold on ever so tightly, turning to unimaginable and unthinkable thoughts and actions that contradicts one's core values and ethics, even one's family. For this is the capacity and the function of fear. It grows and grows, creating other emotions and feelings like distrust, isolation, rejection of anything that does not look or sound familiar. Thus, disengagement from social communities that do not look like ours, and our inner groups and perspectives become smaller and smaller, narrower and narrower. Fear multiplies and multiplies, and spreads all over the place. It abounds, leaving very little room for love. God's love that heals and reconciles. Somehow fear becomes the motivating vehicle of our self-interest, of our self-preservation, at all costs, cementing itself into our lives, but more than that, cementing it into the lives of our children, of those around us. And world preservation, the advancement of others, no longer matters. Patience, compassion, justice, truth, forgiveness, trust, and hope fade away, and fear overcomes us. Where does one go to be free from such fear? Where can we be released from such fear? Where can we be healed from such sinful fear? I would love to say an uplifting American Christian church has a place that addresses, alleviates, heals, and stops such fear. That's painful to say. For much of what evangelicalism, Protestantism, Pentecostalism, Catholicism, and even our own Lutheranism has aided in the rise of its present day fear. All culpable groups, evidenced by the silence, by the lack of boldness to speak out against such injustice and sin, is still this phenomenon. It's not something necessarily human. History tells us all we need to know about this ancient principality known as fear. From the colonization of indigenous peoples, all while using Christianity to justify the subjugation, promoting the idea that European culture and religion is superior, and therefore intertwining racial hierarchy with Christian beliefs. That, of course, birthed the groundwork, shall we say, for the enslavement of African peoples, using selected biblical interpretation of scripture to again justify slavery, to gain free labor, while taking on the kind of ideology. Doctrine of manifest destiny, which may bind Americans to divinely ordaining a moral act, shall we say, to expand across the North American continent, stealing lands, committing genocide among indigenous communities, further enshrined hermanas, a mis hermanos, a mis hermanas. Calvary by the sea, it is important to realize that fear persists. It remains in our society, taking a hold of many of our siblings. And as the Church of Jesus Christ, who is called to respond to the cries of injustice, we must address such a thing. We must eliminate it. We must put an end to it and stop it in the name of a liberating Trinitarian God, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, Father, Son, and Spirit, who was, who is, and who is to come, will perfect their love in us. Your point is that this teaching is not just for antiquity. It's not just for biblical times. It's not only for the table of antiquity, but also for the table of today, for our table. We too may feel like there is not enough room for everyone. We too neglect the practice of justice in God's love. We too respond out of scarcity rather than abundance. We too may overcome by you. So how can we be liberated from such specific fear? Well, liberation from fear can only truly be discovered in the perfected love of God. This makes a ton of sense, right? As love is the antidote to fear. How can God's love be perfected in us? How does that happen? This is the language of the Scriptures. It says, there is no fear in love. The perfect love casts out fear. Whoever fears has not been perfected in love, for God gave us a spirit not of fear, but of power and love and self-control. If we love each other, God remains in us. And his love is perfect. Our love for one another, that God's love remains in us. That is how God's love is perfected in us when we love one another. It's fascinating to me. Does it say anything about a ritual, a prayer, a song, a liturgy? It says to love your neighbor and you want God's love to be perfected. I end with one of my favorite scriptures from 1 Corinthians. Speaking about God's love, and I use it as a full repudiation of fear and its sinful tactics. There's a tip of God's love in you. Love is patient. Love is kind. It is generous. It doesn't brag. It isn't arrogant. It isn't rude. It doesn't seek its own advantage. It isn't irritable. It doesn't keep a record of complaints. It isn't happy with injustice. But it's time to get the truth. Love puts up with all things, trusts in all things, hopes for all things, endures all things. Love never fails. Friends, there is room for everyone. More than enough for everyone. God's love is made perfect in us. So love your neighbor. For this is the way to overcome. Word of God and word of life, we all say together.